Good morning, everyone. Welcome to worship here at Prince of Peace. I'm Pastor Molly Eversall, and it is wonderful to be with you all on this, maybe one of the final hurrahs of summer morning today. Thank you for being here in worship. Today is an exciting day. We will welcome some new members into our community this morning. So after worship, please wish them all well and congratulate them and welcome them and include them into your wonderful community here. Then today, directly after worship, we will be holding the annual meeting, so please, please stick around for that. It will be brief and to the point, and we appreciate your attendance for that as well. Today is also a communion Sunday, so if you did not have a chance, there are the individual communion cups, and they can be found at the back of the sanctuary. A reminder that they are indeed a little bit difficult to open, so there's the little cellophane on top that you peel first to get the wafer, and then the next level to get the grape juice. So it takes some art and some skill, that's for sure. But you all are probably pros at this point. Then you're welcome to follow along on the screens for worship today as well. So let us take a moment to turn our hearts and our minds to worship. And as you are comfortable, please stand for our confession and forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God whose teaching is life, whose presence is sure, and whose love is endless. Amen. Let us confess our sins in the presence of God and of one another. God, our comforter, like lost sheep, we have gone astray. We gaze upon abundance and see scarcity. We turn our faces away from injustice and oppression. We exploit the earth with our apathy and greed. Free us from our sin, gracious God. Listen when we call out to you for help. Lead us by your love to love our neighbors as ourselves. Amen. All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. By the gift of grace in Christ Jesus, God makes you righteous. Receive with glad hearts the forgiveness of all your sins. Amen. Please join us in singing our gathering hymn, number 526, God is Here.
Thank you. I invite you to be seated. I invite any children who are here to come up and join me. Good morning, guys. Good morning. Will you guys remind me your names? You want to go first?
Megan.
All right, Megan. It's okay. You don't have to. That's all right. Okay, so today we're going to do something kind of special in worship. We're going to welcome new members into our community. Does anybody have any idea what it means to be a new member of a church? No? No idea at all? Any idea, Megan? No, not really. No. Well, I wonder, what does it mean to be a member of a family? What does it involve to be a member of your family? Anybody have any ideas about that? No, not at all? Okay. No, not either, Megan? Nothing? What about if you're a part of a family, do you expect that your family loves you?
Yes.
Yeah? Yes. That's a yes for that one. If you're a part of a family, do you expect to be included in stuff that your family does?
Yeah.
Like, yeah, if your family goes places, you expect to come along too, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. What about if you're a part of a family, are you expected to do some chores around the house?
Yeah, probably.
Well, being a part of a church family is similar and different sometimes, but it means that we remember that we are loved by one another and by Jesus most of all. It means that we're included in things and we're welcomed into things. And it also means that sometimes we play a part and we do different things to help out the church and our church family members. Does that make sense? Yeah, it's kind of similar to being a part of a family. Absolutely, but above it all, we are held in God's love when we are part of a church family. Yeah, see, now you know, right? So you can pass that quiz next time, right? Yeah. So let's pray. Gracious God, we give you thanks for members of our community, for visitors, and all those who are a part of your wonderful family, beloved children of God. We pray that as members of this community, we would love one another, include one another, and do our part to be your disciples in this world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, thank you guys. You can go have your seat. Friends, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
For peace in our hearts, for peace in our hearts.
I invite you to join with me in the prayer of the day. Let us pray. O God, our teacher and guide, you draw us to yourself and welcome us as beloved children. Help us to lay aside all envy and selfish ambition, that we may walk in your ways of wisdom and understanding as servants of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. You may be seated.
Good morning. I have to adjust. I just had cataract surgery. Not sure what I can see and can't. Our first reading is taken today from Jeremiah, the 11th chapter. It was the Lord who made it known to me, and I knew then you showed me their evil ways. But I was like a gentle lamb led to the slaughter, and I did not know it was against me that they devised schemes, saying, let us destroy the tree with its fruit. Let us cut him off from the land of the living, so that his name will no longer be remembered. But you, O Lord of hosts, who judge righteously, who try the heart and the mind, let me see your retribution upon them. For to you I have committed my cause. Word of God, word of life. Thanks be to God. We will read Psalm 54 responsively. Save me, O God, by your name. In your might, defend my cause. Hear my prayer, O God. Give ear to the words of my mouth. For strangers have risen up against me, and the ruthless have sought my life, those who have no regard for God. Behold, God is my helper. It is the Lord who sustains my life. Render evil to those who spy on me. In your faithfulness, destroy them. I will offer you a freewill sacrifice and praise your name, O Lord, for it is good. For you have rescued me from every trouble, and my eye looks down on my enemies. Our second reading is taken from the book of James. Who is wise and understanding among you? Show by your good life that your works are done with gentleness born of wisdom. But if you have bitter envy and selfish ambition in your hearts, do not be boastful and false to the truth. Such wisdom does not come down from above, but is earthly, unspiritual, devilish. For where there is envy and selfish ambition, there will also be disorder and wickedness of every kind. But the wisdom from above is first pure, then peaceable, gentle, willing to yield, full of mercy and good fruits, without a trace of partiality or hypocrisy. And a harvest of righteousness is sown in peace for those who make peace. Those conflicts and disputes among you, where do they come from? Do they not come from your craving that are at war within you? You want something and do not have it, so you commit murder. And you covet something and cannot obtain it, so you engage in disputes and conflicts. You do not have because you do not ask. You ask and do not receive because you ask wrongly, in order to spend what you get on your pleasure. Submit yourselves, therefore, to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. Word of God, word of life. Thanks be to God.
The The Holy Gospel according to St. Mark in the 9th chapter. They went on from there and passed through Galilee. He did not want anyone to know it, for he was teaching his disciples, saying to them, "The Son of Man is to be betrayed into human hands, and they will kill him, and 3 days after being killed, he will rise again." But they did not understand what he was saying and were afraid to ask him. Then they came to Capernaum, and when he was in the house, he asked them, "What were you arguing about along the way?" But they were silent, for on the way they argued with one another who was the greatest. He sat down, called the 12, and said to them, "Whoever wants to be first must be last of all and servant of all." Then he took a little child and put it among them, and taking it in his arms, he said to them, "Whoever welcomes one such child in my name welcomes me. And whoever welcomes me welcomes not me, but the one who sent me." The Gospel of our Lord. Glory to you, O Lord. You may be seated. So my favorite line from our gospel message from today is the disciples saying they did not understand and they were afraid to ask him. I just think that's wonderfully honest. And of course, they were kind of afraid. Who remembers what Jesus said to Peter last weekend, last Sunday? Anybody? Yes, get behind me, Satan. Right? No wonder they were afraid. Jesus is feeling the pressure of what is to come, and his words at times are harsh on the disciples, those faltering and messy friends who just can never seem to get it right. And today is no different. We get that iconic moment from the disciples asking who among them will be the greatest. They're concerned about which one of them is Jesus' best man, who is the favorite among them. And they begin to argue about it. And Jesus knows that they have been arguing about it. And I wouldn't say that he is too pleased with them in this moment. The disciples can't seem to get it right. And they know that they don't get it right, hence the silence that we experience from them. Their silence is kind of their shame. But I myself understand this fight to be the greatest. And I have experienced this in my own household over this past week. I recently adopted 2 kittens from my sister, who was fostering these cats. And I already had an older cat in my house. Now, some of you may understand what it is like to bring new pets in when you have old ones. It's not great. But my older cat was always so used to being the queen of the castle, the beloved only child. And now her place in the grand scheme of things has shifted. And she knows it, and she doesn't like it. Her spot on my lap is often taken by one of the kittens. Her litter box has been used. Her bedroom has been infiltrated. Life is very hard for my older cat right now. And those kittens are so sweet, but they overstep their boundaries a lot. The other day, I set out treats for my older cat because we have this routine that I do that every morning. And one of the kittens came over and was eating her treats, and I look up and see my older cat sitting across the room just giving us death glares. The hierarchy in the house has been upset, and everyone is wondering who will be the greatest. I don't know if you all have experienced this in life, but we ourselves also often want to be seen as the greatest. We want to be number one. We want to be at the top of society. That's the way our world often works. But that is not the way that the kingdom of God works. And so Jesus reminds the disciples yet again because they, like all of us, need a little reminding from time to time that it's really not about being the greatest. And to do so, Jesus uses that example of children. I know that image of Jesus welcoming the little children coming to him is often sweet, and we often sentimentalize it. But honestly, that's not quite what is happening here. You see, children in biblical times were thought of very differently than we see children today. They were in a very, very low social position. Many of them didn't survive, and therefore not much effort or attention was put into them. Their purpose was to serve and to work as soon as possible so that they could help sustain their families, families that were often living in poverty and barely had enough to eat. It didn't mean that children weren't loved necessarily. It's just that since they couldn't do much, they weren't high on society's pecking order. A child had nothing to offer anyone in terms of honor or status, and they didn't rate very highly. The message is not to be childlike in curiosity or innocence. The message is to be like a child, to be humble. Humble as though you were someone who, like a child, was the least of these. And that is the message that is directly pointed at those disciples who are arguing over which one of them is the greatest. But to be humble like that, and to be a servant, that is a lot to ask of us at times, because our ego often gets in the way. Someone in my Bible study the other week brought up this verse and responded, "Well, who can be a servant like Jesus?" "No one," he said. To be a servant like Jesus is indeed a heavy, heavy job description. You see, Jesus is the servant, and the culmination of Jesus' service is found on the cross, which he is yet again today trying to explain to those disciples. And the cross is a difficult subject. I know that many of us have kind of our ideas about what the cross means, and we repeat phrases like, "Jesus died for our sins on the cross." But sometimes that doesn't always include what it fully means to be a servant like Jesus on the cross. You see, not much longer after this gospel text, Jesus is being arrested in the Garden of Gethsemane. He is taken, he is tried by Pontius Pilate, and he is crucified because of who he is and because of his ministry. And it is his ministry that makes him a servant of the poor, of the outcast, of women and Gentiles, of demoniacs and lepers. Jesus is persecuted. Jesus goes to the cross because of the people that he serves and those teachings that uplift the lowly and put those who see themselves as the greatest in their place. Jesus dies because of who he is serving in the world, and because that is threatening to those who are powerful. Jesus dies as a servant, and the disciples can't live up to that costly discipleship. In the garden, they deny him and their involvement, but Jesus doesn't turn them in. He dies so that they don't have to face the culpability to the Romans or the religious leaders. Because if the disciples had stuck around, if they had not denied Jesus, if they did so, they would be the ones who would be on his left and on his right on the cross, crucified alongside of him, knowing what it really means to be the least of these. But maybe the point is that Jesus knew that they would deny him. He knew that they wouldn't be able to live up to the cross or that costly discipleship. Jesus knew that they would fail, and yet Jesus still loves them. Jesus still proclaims forgiveness for them. Jesus is still willing to die in their place, to take the fall. That is how Jesus is the servant. And now you may be shaking in your boots a little bit here, because that is a big undertaking, right? To be a servant like Christ, to become the least of these. And today, as we are welcoming and hopefully not scaring off new members, this text reminds all of us that discipleship is hard. The type of discipleship that Jesus requires is hard to accept, and it means that there are times in our lives where, even though we are striving, we can't live up to that. We will be like the disciples who will fail at times. So it's good to remember something. In one of my favorite hymns, The Summons, there is a line that goes like this: "Will you let me be your servant? Let me be as Christ to you." So often, when we think of what a good disciple is, we get very bogged down by what we should do. Are we being a good enough servant? Are we being a good enough disciple? And I dare say we ask, like those disciples with Jesus, are we being the greatest disciple? We get caught up in that cycle in a way that is not a cycle of grace, by trying to do the very thing that Jesus asks of us. We do the thing that Jesus chastises the disciples for. So today, I want us to think of it just a little bit differently. It can be overwhelming and full of pressure to take on all of how we see a good disciple, because we will fall short at times. So I want us to take a minute and take the focus off of ourselves as disciples, and to think of the people who have been Christ to us, those who have been a servant to us and shown us the beauty of discipleship that Jesus asks for. As I myself was considering this, I thought first of my chaplaincy supervisor when I was working in the hospital as a chaplain. When I served in the hospital, it was very hard for me. It was hard because I had this mindset, like the disciples, that I was going to be the greatest chaplain that there ever was. I believed somehow that I needed to go in there and to solve everyone's problems, to heal their hurts. And that is not a realistic goal. It's just not how it works. There was one woman who I deeply cared about. She was struggling with addiction. She was detoxifying in the hospital. She would suffer from relapse and ultimately come back to the hospital and start everything all over again. I felt connected to her a lot because we were about the same age, and honestly, I just really liked her. I listened to her stories and everything that was going on in her life, and I would share with her sermons from my favorite pastors. I wanted to be there for her, but I also wanted so badly for her to be well, for her to get better, and for her to do the right thing for her to get there. One morning, I was going to see her, and I found out that she had left the hospital, AMA, meaning against medical advice. And I felt terrible. I felt like I had failed her, and I felt angry and disappointed that she hadn't done the right thing. After that happened, I was talking with Barry, who was my chaplaincy supervisor, and he reminded me of the story of the Good Samaritan. He reminded me what the Good Samaritan does. The Good Samaritan does take notice of that neighbor in need. The Good Samaritan gets the poor soul who is beaten up and damaged, and he gets him to the inn. And then the Good Samaritan moves along. The Good Samaritan can't do everything for this person and make sure that they are perfect and that the rest of their life is golden. The Good Samaritan just does their part and trusts that in doing so, they are following Jesus, that they are being a good disciple. It was such a relief to hear this. In that moment, a weight lifted off of me and that need to fix the situation subsided. On that day, Barry, my supervisor, was Christ to me because he reminded me that to follow Jesus means two things. It means that you do your best to follow in Christ's ways, to be a servant. But it also is remembering that when we fail or when we fall short, there is always grace. There is always the Christ who is the servant who proclaims forgiveness for us and for those that deny or reject him. There is always the Christ that loves us, whether we are the greatest or whether we are the least. Amen. I invite you to join us in singing our hymn of the day, number 731, Earth and All Stars.
Thank you.
During this time, I'd like to invite all of those who will be received as our new members to join me at the front, please. Dear friends, we give thanks for the gift of baptism for those people one with us in the body of Christ, whom we welcome as new members into our life and ministry of this congregation. Today, we welcome into the community of Prince of Peace, Gail, Sarah Ramsey, and Arden Bott, Wayne and Brandy Goodwin, Al Hendra, Jim Klein, and Andy and Jillian Van Dyke. Some of those couldn't be here with us today, but we are welcoming them anyway, so welcome them next time you see them. With the whole church, let us together confess our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. In baptism, we are welcomed into the body of Christ and sent to share in the mission of God. We are called to live among God's faithful people, to hear the word of God and share in the Lord's Supper, to proclaim in the good news of God in Christ through word and deed, to serve all people following the example of Jesus, and to strive for justice and peace in all the earth. Sisters and brothers in Christ, do you intend to continue the covenant of your baptism among God's people in this place? Please respond, I do, and I ask God to help and guide me.
I do.
Wonderful. People of God, do you promise to support and pray for these new members in their life in Christ?
We do. We ask God to help and guide us.
Let us welcome these sisters and brothers in Christ to this community of faith. We rejoice with you in the life of baptism. Together we give thanks and praise to God and proclaim the good news to all the world. We give you thanks for our new members whom you have drawn to yourself by the love of Jesus Christ and whom we have welcomed into this household of faith. Keep us close together in your spirit, in breaking of bread and in our prayers and in our service to one another. Let us welcome our new members. We continue with our prayers of intercession.
Let us pray. Made children and heirs of God's promise, we pray for the church, the world, and all in need. God of community, we pray for the church around the world. Unite us in our love for you. Help us overcome our divisions, that we are encouraged to work together for your sake. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
God of creation, we pray for this hurting earth. Awaken in us a new desire to care for this world and empower us to support agencies, organizations, and individual efforts to heal our environment. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of cooperation, we pray for nations of the world embroiled in conflict. Inspire leaders to listen to each other and work toward peaceful solutions to disagreements. Protect the vulnerable, especially children, who cannot find safety in their home or country. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of comfort, we pray for all who live with mental or physical illness, especially Judy Payne, Corey Heitman, Lonnie Hess, Gail Johnson, Christy Pyraki, Tina Gutzman, Rena Ruinen, Ellen Tilbaka, Kelly Hendrickson, Alex, Bev Goodell, Bob and Nancy Ranta, Harper Curtis, Bob Ball, Darwin Britton, Dan Vertinen, Emily, Cassie, Diana, the family and friends of Richard Clark, and the family and friends of John Lindholm. Here other names may be offered either silently or aloud. Help them find appropriate care, bringing healing and wholeness when the path forward seems bleak, Lord. In your mercy, hear our prayer. God of compassion, we pray for the young people of this congregation. Renew in us your call to welcome the children in our midst. As they grow, strengthen their faith and our commitment to them. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
God of consolation, we give you thanks for the loved ones who have died and pray for all who grieve today, especially the family and friends of Richard Clark. Shine your grace on all your saints. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Receive these gifts, O God, and those in our hearts known only to you through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
The peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
I invite you to please stand and share a sign of peace with one another. I invite you to stand as you are comfortable.
Let us pray in thanksgiving for the offerings
which we have given as a gift
to God.
Let us pray.
God of abundance, you cause streams to break forth in the desert and manna to rain from the heavens.
Accept the
gifts you have given
us. Unite them with the offering of our lives to nourish the world you love so dearly.
Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift
up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed our duty and our joy that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through Jesus Christ
our Lord,
who on this day overcame death and the grave and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so with the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven,
we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Holy, mighty, and merciful Lord, heaven and earth are full of your glory. In great love, you sent to us Jesus, your Son, who reached out to heal the sick and the suffering, who preached good news to the poor, and who on the cross opened his arms for all. It was in the night in which our Lord Jesus Christ was betrayed that he took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." And again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. It is shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering, therefore, his death, resurrection, and ascension, we await his coming in glory. Pour out upon us the spirit of your love, O Lord, and unite the wills of all who share in this heavenly food, the body and blood of Jesus Christ, our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be all honor and glory now and forever. Amen. Gathered together into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus first taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, and we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Friends, this is Christ's table, and all are welcome to take part in the meal which Jesus has given for us, his very self, his body, and his blood. I invite you to commune one another, saying, "This is the body of Christ given for you, and the blood of Christ shed for you." Thank you. And now, with the joyous sounds of the crinkling cups, please receive the blessing. Now may the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you always in God's grace. Amen. Let us pray. We give you thanks, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us through the healing power of this gift of life. In your mercy, strengthen us through this gift in faith towards you and in fervent love towards one another, for the sake of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Amen. We continue with our hymns, Children of the Heavenly Father. Together, let us pray. Lord of life, in the gift of your body and blood, you turn the crumbs of our faith into a feast of salvation. Send us forth into the world with shouts of joy, bearing witness to the abundance of your love. In Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. We join together in singing, Just As I Am, Without One Plea.
Thank you.
Looking ahead to this week, we have a few announcements. First of all, a reminder that after worship will be our annual meeting, so please stick around for that. Then tonight is the first confirmation class of the year at 6:30 p.m. If you know a student who would still like to participate in that, it's never too late. Then this Wednesday, it looks like we have worship and music meeting at 7 p.m. On Thursday is our monthly council meeting, also at 7 p.m. On Friday at 9:30 is the gardeners, and Friday is also the last day to please submit newsletter articles for PACS. Then Saturday at 11, we have our women's Bible study gathering together and worship again on Sunday. Then another reminder that the crop walk will happen on October 6th at 1:30 at Hope Church. In the back is a list of walkers you can see on the wall. There are little footprints there. So if you would like to support them, please do so. Or if you would like to walk yourself, you are welcome to do that as well. I invite you to stand to receive the benediction.
Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you with grace and mercy. May the Lord look upon you with favor and grant you peace. Amen.
Go in peace, the living word dwells within you. Thanks be to God. But please stick around for the annual meeting as well. I think we'll take just a few moments to get everything ready, and if you'd like to take a bathroom break or anything like that, please do so now.